Hi. So I just wanted to make sure this is the last session. So if you are not here for this talk, there are other talks too. So, and I will try to make it compact as much as possible. But my goal of this talk is to understand you don't stuck into one tool or methodology. I think you should ask why and what I am monitoring. It's more important for me than any kind of tool you are using. So let me tell something about this guy. So I joined on Monday, University of Maryland Medical Systems. So before that, I used to work at Medallia with me, and before that I was working at OmniTI. I have worked with probably more than a dozen databases, SQL and NoSQL databases, and work with more than a dozen monitoring systems too. Still Medallia email? Sorry. Okay. You can reach me at Twitter or Gmail account. I think the other email will bounce. Right now, I'm hiring senior database engineers and system administrators in Baltimore. If you're looking for a job, let me know. I'm building a new team to migrate very large medical system from Oracle to Postgres and Hadoop. I blog sometimes at pateldanis.com. You can reach me through Twitter as well. And I run a Slack channel. If you are not on Postgres Slack channel, I think this is the right time to be on it. There are probably 1,000 people on Slack. They communicate on different topics. If you have a problem, if you are learning about conferences, experience with different databases, FDWs, there are a lot of channels in there that you can start your own. Okay, today we are gonna talk about what? Yeah, so what you are looking for, like if you must be aware, I think there are a lot of solutions available. There are commercial and open source products available. What you should be looking for when you are selecting a monitoring solution. Sometimes you have luxury to select one. Sometimes you have to use the one that already there. So I think those are the things I'm going to talk about, like what things to look, which metrics to collect. So monitoring is like, there are three parts of it: collection, trending, and alerting. So I think you should look for what to collect first, then what most of the things, whatever you are collecting will be trended. And then you have to choose wisely what you want to alert on. Otherwise, you will be getting alerts, all sort of alerts that you don't care about. Yeah, that's what we're gonna talk about, what to alert on and what, like, monitoring is like ever-growing topic that doesn't stop because Postgres comes with the new features. So in Postgres 8, you couldn't able to monitor some things that you can monitor in 9.1, 9.2, 9.4, 9.5 has new features, and 9.6 will coming up a lot more features for monitoring. So if you are not keeping track of monitoring things they are adding, I think you are not actually using those. And they are, the features that are coming up are very important. So if you start keeping track of those features, so it's very easy to keep track. So whenever there is a major release or minor release comes out, the monitoring features are normally listed out separately. So it's very easy to find them out. And how to react on alerts at 3 a.m. like, and I will give some advice, but most of the things that you might already know. An open discussion, like as I said, there are probably 50 monitoring tools that I know of. So I might be talking maybe a couple, maybe five, but I would like to know like what are the other monitoring tools you are using and what are the factors that were taken into consideration for selecting. So like from my perspective, like what are the things I normally look whenever I select the monitoring solution is, I think it's a blend of both. Like I don't want to have just a single Postgres database monitor that I only DBS cares about. Like the system guys have their own tool, the operations guy their own, and then the financial has their own tool. So I think it's very difficult, like, because if you are The goal of IT is to help business. So if it's an integrated tool, that will be really important. So I think centralized monitoring, that's the keyword. So I think I have worked with the companies that has like Datadog, Wavefront, and other monitoring, and everything is like kind. You need to find out where to look for. So it's very difficult. So it's always good idea to have a centralized monitoring. The other question you would like to ask it is a hosted solution versus on-premise. So some companies like security concerns like me, I will be using on-premise solution because I can't afford to have PII data or like, because Postgres is kind of very like, if you are trying to insert a row and it's a primary key violation, it will log that name and ID, everything in the log, and if it is going somewhere, that's a log entry, and it could be possible through the monitoring solution as well. So normally people don't like to send on the hosted, but there are a lot of companies, they don't care, and they keep track of those monitoring systems differently. So it depending on the industry you are working on, how you want to manage that. Alerting, you want to make sure that whatever solution you are using does provide the alerting capability, or dashboards, graphs, easy to installation configuration, because if you are running like hundreds of systems, then I think manual installation is not right way to do it. So as long as they provide some kind of automated tools for installation and configuration, that's what you should be looking into. Do they provide a database support like Postgres or any other databases that you are using it? PGStat statements is the great tool for monitoring. So PGStat statement is the extension in Postgres that you can have it, so you can log all the queries ran on the Postgres database. So do they provide integration of that? If not, like there is a way to do it. So those kind of things you should look into. Resource monitoring, there are four resources in IT world, right? CPU, RAM, disk, IO, and network on the system side. So I think just look at what are the things they can give as a plugin or easy for installation. PG Bouncer support, like PG Bouncer is the, what it's called? Connection pooling, yes. That's the word, connection pooling. So if does it like, because if you have PG Bouncer and then you are not monitoring it, I think you are doing something wrong. Like you should be looking at like what, which clients are waiting and it's not. Those kind of things are very important. So that's a lot of things you should be looking at. So I am going to talk about some of the solutions that I have worked in the past and been working now. So these are the open source solution I just selected out of many. Like Sensu is pretty nice open source monitoring suit. Jabbix, Genos, Nagios. I think Nagios has done great job in our industry to actually educate us how to monitor, but now it should die. So I think you should search on that blog post. And I think, yeah, I think it did a great job. Now I think it's the next generation of monitoring solutions to be there. Nagios is, it's like it's pretty old now. It's very difficult to manage compared to, and it's not keeping up with the new things, so that's why. Like otherwise, there are a lot of companies are still using Nagios. So it's up to you. But I think you should read that blog. That will give you more insight why. SaaS offering, I have worked Wavefront, Sakonas, Vivid Cortex, OKMeter, New Relic, and there are many that I haven't got chance to work on. So I will do quick comparison between like solutions. So does all of them are providing Postgres support? Like if you are using Nagios, is the Nagios, I think Check Postgres. Most of them are using Check Postgres plugin. Easy to like, Sensu is easy to configure. You still need to have graphite for graphing. The recommendation confidence is pretty high. I like Sensu for sure. I think Jabbix and Genos are good, but like that's my medium level of recommendation. I think Genos is more closed source. And Nagios is pretty low now. I think Sensu is built on top of Nagios, how Nagios had some problems. So Sensu tried to solve those problems. It's a recommendation confidence from my, yeah. It could differ day by day. SAAS offerings. So for Wavefront, that's the thing I'm going to talk about in this talk, but it doesn't matter. As long as you know what to collect, then you can put your monitoring tool. You can send that data to monitoring tool, and they should be able to graph on it, like trend on it and alert on it. Circonus. So configuration is like I'm using Wavefront with CollectD plugin. Circonus, there are some default checks. So once you start a Postgres, they will allow you to like 10, maybe 10 different default checks that will be created by default. Vivid Cortex has a default checks too. It's pretty interesting monitoring tool too. OK Meter, that's the one I recently played around, and it's a one-click installation. It's like a Vivid Cortex, but it's built specifically for Postgres. Like, you can install it, and then it just works. But it's not like it's a hosted solution, so there's no solution for on-premise. New Relic is pretty interesting too, but I have worked into it with it, but like there are some plugins available, but there are some of the things, there are a lot of things are missing from those plugins. So as long as you know what to monitor, and if you can change those plugins to do whatever you are trying to collect, then I think that might be a good idea for you to use New Relic if it is already used. If the other things are already using New Relic, there is no reason to just use other tools. You can just modify the plugins and you can use it. So in the SaaS offering, I think a lot of things you can still compare aside from basic things, like more advanced, like does it provide capacity planning? So on the disk or so there are like Circonus, for example, provide a capacity planning capability. So you can actually project the growth for next 3 years, 5 years in your in the dashboard. So that's very important. Real-time analytics is another thing, like can you write queries directly, like in Wavefront, I can write a TS queries directly and do some real-time analytics. Anomaly detection. So I think Vivid Cortex has been working on that for a long time. Like, so I think that means like sometimes like having high CPU usage doesn't mean that everything is broken. As long as you understand the anomaly and react on that, I think it's very important to know. And it's also a research project, so hopefully that will help whoever is on call. I think it will helpful for them to not wake up in the night more often. Data retention is the thing, like if you are working the SaaS offering, you want to make sure that some of the companies, they only allow you to look at the data for certain period of time, like 1 year, 5 years, sometimes 1 month. So it doesn't, I think it's not useful if you can only see your data for 1 month, because you want to actually compare for last year. Then I think you should ask that question in advance, like how much data I should be able to go back. Some companies like Circonus, they never delete your data. They keep forever, but there is a cost penalty to it, but I think you need to understand that. Support reviews, like there are, as I said, like now market is very competitive, so understand like who is using other tools and get the reviews. And pricing is pretty important. If you are monitoring 100 system versus 100,000 system, so if you can't scale the pricing, I don't think so that's the tool that you will be looking into. So you might want to start with Sensu. So, yeah, there are some things that I work recently, so I just came up with some good ideas about Wavefront. Like, it has a nice dashboard, alerting functionality, scalable solution, real-time analytics, complete monitor. And I just compared with the OK Meter because that's something new I just recently played with. So there is no why I did not put Vivid Cortex here, right? There is nothing, there is no correlation. I just, Yeah, it does provide, like, I just installed the OKMeter agent, and then it gave me all the graphs that I was looking for. So it was pretty cool. Very easy to install, configured. Like, I was using PG Bouncer, so the PG Bouncer monitoring is built in. So you don't have to, like, do anything. If you want to install Postgres server, you just install that agent, and all the graphs are already there. So it was pretty interesting. Yes. This is SaaS offering, both of them, Wavefront and OKMeter. Yeah, PG Bouncer stats. Like, you can actually dig down into client using server connection, connections per IP address, average query time in from PG Bouncer, those kind of things. So even though you are not using this, what you should be doing is, like, for example, I am using let's say New Relic. But I should actually download OKMeter on the test instance and see what they are monitoring. Can I do that in New Relic or not? If not, like, what are the challenges? You can actually do that, those kind of things. And so that will help you to understand, like, what are the things that are very important, why the other people are doing and why I'm not doing. So that's something you can play around. Like, you just need to install it. And they will give you maybe 1 month free, but by that time you will know, like, these are the things are very important to me, because some people don't know PG Bouncer stats, like what to collect. So just install it and see, like, what they are collecting. Can we do this? It's very simple. Monitoring solutions. So the solution I selected Wavefront because I had a challenge to, like, monitor 150 dB clusters across the globe. I wanted to have easy installation standard because everybody else is using centralized. Real-time analytics was very important for me. And the new infrastructure we were building, like Docker, Aurora, Mesos, so can it scalable? Like, because we'll be running probably 100,000 Docker instances. If I can't able to, if the monitoring solutions can't able to scale with that, I think that's not the right tool for you. So we chose Wavefront because it was, we already using it, and it was coming up with this criteria. Like, we tested it on Docker, and because it was working with the CollectD, so once you install CollectD agent in all your Docker instances, it will just send data. So it was very easy to roll out. So that's the thing we'll be talking about for rest of the talk, is what to collect. So what I am collecting, and I might be missing something, that's why I'm here. Like, if you are collecting a lot more than me, then I think I should learn from you guys. So first of all, I did set up a role, because normally I don't provide a super role to monitoring role. So I just created a CollectD role, schema, install schema CollectD, search path, grant usage to the CollectD, and I made sure that there is no super role for CollectD user, so limited permission. And why it's separate role, because sometimes when you want to exclude in the logs that, okay, I don't want to see anything related to CollectD, just give me information about my application because I don't care about monitoring right now. So that helps you to, so having a separate role will help you to understand if something goes bad, like you can actually track it down. And no super role is very important because you don't want to grant permission. And for not having this, like, you have to do some extra steps, but I think it's worth it. So CollectD plugin is pretty simple. Like, it does, you can just install on any system, Linux or Solaris system, very easily. So it will come with the Postgres SQL plugin. So by default, it comes with the top part up to query plans. Those are the basic monitoring it comes with. But I added the other ones that are listed as a custom. So you can add your own metrics or queries that you want to monitor. That's not listed over here as well. Like, I want to monitor something else other than this, like how many tables my database has. Like I can just write another query, number of tables, and write a query, select count star from PG tables where schema is this, and it will start monitoring. So yeah, it's very easy to configure. So once you know the flow, like you can add a lot more monitoring tools, monitoring queries in it. And it will send the data, then it's up to the monitoring tool to consume that data. It could be Sensu, it could be anything you talk like. I think most of the SaaS tools are also supporting CollectD, so it's pretty industry standard. So the first one they give is backends. It doesn't give a lot of information. It just give you count star from pgstat activity of that data for that database name. So number of connections, actually. But this query will not work if you are using CollectD role as it is, because I did not give super role permission. So if the role is not super user, then it will only see the session it is connected. Otherwise, it will say insufficient permission to see the query. So for that, I created a function, pgstat activity. It's a security definer function. So what it does, it just query the select from pgstat activity, revoke all function from public, and grant just execution permission to the CollectD role. So now if the CollectD role will try to get that data, it will get from pgstat activity from CollectD schema itself. So that way, you don't have to provide a super role permission to CollectD role. It can still get all the details, all the data it needs to look at it. This will be changing in Postgres 10, but right now you have to do it until 9.6. Transactions. So that's another thing you are like, normally whenever two DBAs meet, like they normally ask like, what's your transaction rate of your database, right? Like how there are two questions normally, like how big is your database and what's the transaction rate for database? So if you don't know, I think embarrassing. Like, so I think I would just put this query in there and select commits and rollback, just get a commits, how many commits are happening and how many rollbacks are happening on my database. That will give you the transaction rate for your database. 223. DML, the another thing is like DML queries, how many updates, insert, deletes are happening. So that is another question people ask, like your workload is mostly read-only, 80% read, 20% write. Is it like 80% write versus 20% read? What is that? So you can get that detail from here, like how many writes are happening per second by just tracking the update, insert, and delete.
For the whole database, since the database started, right?
Yes. Yep. But in the monitoring tool, you can actually like see the rate. So it will just get the last value and new value. And it will give you the, I think we are looking at the transaction rate, right? We are not looking at the absolute value. So it, you just want to know the rate. So it doesn't matter when it started, because you just care about the last value. And then the monitoring tool will just do the, I think, subtraction between two and just give you the rate. Table stats. Yeah. So I think you want to see the live tuples and dead tuples. I am not going into very detail into like what is live and dead. Like dead is like not used. So you want to just see like sometimes the database is slow, but there are a lot of dead tuples out there, or your database is not vacuuming properly. There are a lot of dead tuples lying around. So if you know like this is always growing up, like why is it so, like you can take a look and do further investigation into it. You don't have to alert on it, but at least to you know there is something going on wrong. I think there was a bug in 8.4 or 9.2, like there was a water vacuum was not processing properly, so those kind of things, you can actually figure it out by looking at your system, because each workload is different. Query plans. So it will give you the sequential scan, sequential tuple read. Sequential scan is number of time from like how many times, summarization of sequential scan, number of scan happening, and how many tuple read is like how many actually fetching from the sequential scan. Then index scan is the same number of, it will be on the database, like all the tables, but suddenly, like if you see the spike on number of sequential scan, you want to take a look, like what changed? Like you want to, it might be possible that query plan has changed now, so one of your largest table is now doing sequential scan, so then you can check between sequential tuple read. That's very important because it will tell you how many actually rows are reading. So you can actually understand that, okay, now I think it's doing the sequential scan, it is going to the disk and fetching all the data. Same thing with the index scan, if you have a proper index or not, like those kind of things. So it's depending on the use case, but as long as you have data, I think you have something to look at it. Disk I/O is like, this is all the checks I'm talking about are already in CollectD. So once you start CollectD, it will grab all this thing without doing anything. So it will give you the block hits, read versus hit. So you can make a sense out of it if you, I think each metric has like one pager or more than that. You can read on the postgresql.org documentation. Just copy from here and paste, and you will learn like what does it mean. Hip disk IO is, what is that? Toast, what is toast and why it is very important, why now we are not having a good toast block hit ratio. Those kind of things are, so you can understand those, and if something changed and you don't know what changed, I think you can correlate those things and help you to investigate performance issues. DB size is very important. Like you need to know like how much it's growing. Sometimes it's growing without growing business. So you know, you want to understand like if the size is growing, I think it's just growing on temp tables, or why it's growing. Like it's just we are storing sessions that's not useful anymore, or it's one table is bloated 80% and it's like the data is only this, but table is like 2 terabyte, but actual data is only 1 terabyte. It's already 50% bloat. So I think you need to understand. So next thing, like it's not here, is you should run a bloat report to see if it is, if you search on Postgres bloat report, you will see a lot of tools and queries available online. So you should look at it that, okay, this thing is bloating, the table is bloating, could be index bloating. So you can re-index online, index can be rebuilt online. If you are on the table, you can rebuild a table online using PG Repack. If you are not aware of that tool, like it's pretty very useful tool I have used for over 5-6 years now on production systems. Recently, 3 months ago, I used on a 5 terabyte database PG Repack. After PG Repack run, it was 2 terabyte. So 3 terabyte of data we could recover from running PG Repack. So that's very, very useful. So all other queries I'm talking about are the custom one that you can add your own to. So as I said earlier, it was a backend. It's a similar, but I think you don't worry about how many connections are that. You really worried about is what those are connection are doing. Are they just sitting in idle? Are they idle in transaction? Are they active? Or what? The state is very important. If somebody tells me I have a 200 connection, that doesn't mean anything to me. But somebody tells me I have 200 connection, 5s are active, then yes. I think you have very, very complex system that 5 connection, active connection are very important. Like you, so you want to know that like some connections are just sitting in idle and transaction for days that you just discovered because the vacuum wasn't effective. So I do actually alert on idle in transaction. For OLTP system is more than a couple of hours, I do get alerted on it. Because you don't want a long-running transaction on your OLTP system, otherwise the system will slow down because vacuum will not be more effective as it has to be. And it does use collectd.pgstat activity, so it doesn't have any permission issue. And the union is doing waiting. Even though there are connections, how many are actually waiting connection? And that, if it is even one waiting connection, I would get like alert on it. But I think I would wait for another couple of maybe 5 minutes and then get alerted on it. So waiting is okay, but waiting for a long period of time is not good. So those kind of things are important. Just number of connection is good idea to collect, but what are the state for those connections are very important. So this is like a simple graph I just throw in from both. The upper one is the wavefront. The bottom one is OK meter. Like there are some differences in the GUI, like the graph design, but the data is almost same. Slow queries. That's something I learned from Genos. So Genos has built-in plugin. They were doing a slow queries, but I wasn't doing it. So what they do is like, they do number of connections are active, and it's been running for more than 300 seconds. And the query like insert, update, delete, or select, we do ignore vacuum, or maybe create index statement, create index concurrently statement. So, but we do care about why the insert has been running for 300 seconds, more than that. And we do get alert if it is this number is more than, I think, 5, then we get page. So that means the system is pretty slow. It can't able to keep up with the transaction we are getting it. So I recently added slow queries, learning from other systems. So that's why it's very important to keep learning. Even though I think you can learn from OK meter like PG bouncer stats. Transaction wraparound. Who doesn't know about transaction wraparound? Problem in Postgres? Search, like, I think two companies got hit last year by transaction wraparound. I think GitHub or some other company. So Postgres do set, like, I think 2 billion transaction. So once you hit 2 billion, it looks pretty big number, 2 billion transaction, but I think you will be surprised how fast you can just crunch in those 2 billion transactions. So if you don't monitor on that number, I think once it hit that 2 billion, the system will go unresponsive and start doing all the vacuum it has to be doing. So that will take higher priority than your business. That you don't need. You want your business to be higher priority than vacuum. And people then will complain about it that, okay, Postgres is slow because it's just doing vacuum. So I think you want to actually look at this age, and it's reaching up to 2 billion, like at least maybe 1.5 billion, and then you really want to get alerted or maybe page and get taken care of, like which table is not vacuumed properly, and you might want to vacuum manually. So it's from database, so yes. But yes, that's right. Internally, that's true, but I think it will take the largest value from the... Yes. So it will list number of tables need vacuum. So the A is, you decide like 1.5 billion, so you want to vacuum everything. It's greater than 1.5 billion transaction. Then the A's will go down after that. Yes. There are a number of things. One thing is a long-running transaction. That's the one thing. In the system, if the long-running transaction is always there, and it can, the auto vacuum can touch that table. Whenever it tries to vacuum it, it will not be able to vacuum it because of some transaction is holding that lock, shared lock, I think. So it will not able to remove that page. So that's the other thing is like when highly transactional system, you might want to tweak the auto vacuum setting as well. Like why? Because some auto vacuum you want to, if it's a highly transactional system, you want to make it more faster. So I think you need to tweak that. If not, then the workaround is like just look at it and get alerted on if it is more than 1.5 billion and see why these tables are not getting vacuumed properly. So that's your next step. First, you need to know that and then learn the tables. Okay, that's good. Locks. The other thing you want to check is the locks, like PG underscore locks table, and you want to see lock is okay. There are normally you see a lot of locks, but if the locks are waiting, then it's a problem. Why it's waiting? So that's something you want to check about. If granted is false and it's waiting, then you want to check why the which resources locks are waiting and which table it's locking. So it's very important to know. This is simple. Val files, that's another thing. So you want to monitor in like how many archived and failed, because sometimes you are using NAS or like shared storage. If it's not available, it will fail to archive. I had that issue once, so that's why I added this check. So you'd learn like if it is failing because my mount point is not available. So you want to learn more faster than suddenly you will come to know from the replication that replication couldn't able to catch up. Scans. So it's a similar thing, but what I am doing different. I think I have only 15 minutes, but I will go to next. Sequential scan is very important because what happened is I did write a separate function to get a sequential scan on large tables because I don't care about small tables if they are sequential scan, but if it is a large table, more than like 100 MB or something, I do care. So what I did is sequential scan on large tables. I did create a materialized view and get all the table states. If the table size is, I think, 100 MB, and put it into materialized view. So the next thing I'm doing is I wrote a function that will be called from the monitoring system. Is like it refresh that materialized view every 4 hours. And in 4 hours, if something spikes up, I know like there's something bad happened. Like suddenly large table is getting sequential scans. And it get alerted and I get page on it. This slide should be available so you can understand. I don't have a lot of time, but that's the basic theory behind it. Like if you want to get sequential scan on the large table, you want to get page about it because otherwise it might slow down or maybe bring down your entire website. Average query time is another thing. It's dependent on the PG stat statement. So PG stat statements do keep all the query time, all the queries ran. I think by default, it keeps about 1,000 queries in PG stat statements view. So you want to collect faster and keep track of the summary, total time, summary time, or you can do on your monitoring system. You just want to get the data and put it into monitoring system and do rolling average or whatever you want to do with that. But get statement, that's another. I created a view on the function just to get rid of that super role permission issue. So this is like average query time, simple graphs. OKMeter has other graphs that I would like to implement further. Like you can actually deep dive into which query has been running so many times. So you can get all those details in pgstat statement. I think it's up to the monitoring, like how you want to interact. You have all the data in pgstat statement. I think now the next step is to figure it out how to grab it, collect it, and send it to the monitoring solution. So that's what the OK meter has done. Like, you can see the queries, how percentage, like they did, like this query has been running 15% of your time. So you can do the same thing for your tool. Which query is using higher disk IO? Which query is like result, how many rows are returned? Because everything is in pgstat statements view, like how many rows are returned by the query itself. So then you just need to bring that details and put it into the graphs and your trending system. Checkpoints, like you want to see like if the it's a checkpoint is timing out or not. Slave lag, like if you are running a slave, is it catching up with the master or not? Like it's a simple query that just it do PG last X act replay timestamp and just you can query it. There's a catch in it, like if your system is not busy enough, this will give you false positive. So there are other checks out there, but I use this because my system is pretty busy and it gives me the whatever I need it for now. Alerting on DB. So you want to alert on uptime, waiting connection, number of connection waiting more than 5. You want to alert on slow queries, number of slow queries. You want to alert on sequential scan on large tables. It's very, very important. Transaction wraparound is even more important than that because you want to get alerted at 1.5 billion transaction. Disk space usage, I think it's up to you. It will bring down the database if it is 100% full. Slave lag, less more than 5 minutes, you want to alert on it. So that's fairly basic, but it will cover mostly three criteria, like the uptime criteria, performance criteria, and resource criteria. Those three bucket you have for alerting. How to keep up? Yeah, that's so design with failover in mind, like so whenever you design a system, it is going to be failed over. So make sure that once you change the host name, the monitoring shouldn't be freak out about it. Like it will be different name, the master name will be different. If you are keep eye on like new features, 9.5 enhancement, commit timestamp tracking in 9.5, that's a new thing you want to start collecting that detail now. Like last committed transaction. The cluster name is the new thing, like now you can have a cluster name. So if you are running multiple cluster on your single server, you can have that different connections names like reports DB versus personal DB. So if you are monitoring on the processes, now you can actually grab on the cluster name. 9.6, waiting on, like, out until now, it was just giving you, it is waiting, but it wasn't giving you why it is waiting. So now in 9.6, you can actually get that detail. So I think you need to tweak that monitoring to provide more information from that. Yeah, you want to use config management tool to just deploy monitoring. You don't want to do by hand, like, manually. Postgres 10 enhancement, like whatever the things I did for getting rid of that super role, it will go away because we are introducing PG underscore monitor role. So it will be a special role that you can use for monitoring. So you cannot log in using PG monitor role, but you can create another role, let's say monitoring role. Then you grant this role to the monitoring role and use that role. So you don't have to worry about that security definer function and all the things that I talked about. But it's coming in next year. So for now, I think you have to use this. Incident management. How to be ready, 5 minutes, 5 minutes, 3 a.m. call. PagerDuty calendar. You want, if you are not familiar, PagerDuty, there are other companies out there. I forgot the name. Document metrics. I think you want to document like why we are, alerting or why we are collecting on it. I think if you don't document, like, people will just, because you are not the only person will be relying on this. So, like, transaction wraparound, like, if you just say this, like, the system guy will just don't do anything about it. Just, it will just ignore, like, this is the term that I don't worry about. I think who cares about wraparound anymore? Alert resolution procedure, make sure you have clear SLAs, escalation policy. Scenarios like wait for server to bring backup, failover scenarios like you want to. Other things I would like to include in monitoring, you want to monitor the backup. Is it getting backed up properly? I would highly encourage to actually restore it, because when you need it, normally it doesn't restore your backup. So make sure you restore it. If you ever never restore your backup, I'm pretty sure it will never work. I have been to that situation before. Failover review alerts. I think recently some GitLab had the same issue, I think, similar issue with the backup with Postgres. Review alerts before going on call. Like when you are going on call, make sure that what alerted last week, be prepared about it. On-call notification, is it working? Like sometimes it's not working at all. So you want to change the tweak, like make a lower threshold and get it alerted once while you are in the office. That happened to me as well. Think worst document, like what if you are in movie theater? Normally whenever I go to movie, whenever I am on call. Because that's the best time to go to movie, because you don't do anything else. What if you can't jump on the server? Like, do you have documentation available for other person on the phone can follow it? What else? Anything else? Clapping. Okay, I think I'm here. So you can ask me any question. I'm on Twitter. Email. If you are not on Slack, you should be on Slack. I think if you don't get anything out of this talk, just be on Slack. Thank you.